Okay. Well, what another blessed Sabbath we're having today. We are going to hopefully close out the series, the work of preparation, with these two final parts 5 and 6. And as we begin, if you'll join me as far as you're able in prayer. Our Holy Father in heaven, what a joy it is to venture into your word. What a joy it is to serve a God who is bent on our blessings instead of the enemy who is bent on our destruction. And dear God, it's even more wonderful that you have all the power to deliver us from the hold of Satan and sin. Father, this Sabbath afternoon, as we've come and joined together and assembled here, we ask and invite for the power and presence of your Holy Spirit to be in our thoughts and our hearts and minds. And Father, for those that would see this material later, I just pray now that your Holy Spirit would draw near to each soul and that your word, your truth, would be lifted up in the proper framework, Father. And please, please hide me. Please let it be now that my words, my thoughts are according to your divine will. I ask these things, Father, but I also ask that you would protect our equipment, that you would fill this place with your holy angels, and that we would have this time especially shut out from the world and enfolded in your love. At this time, we pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen. I've been dealing with or utilizing a three-step template, and that three-step template is described here on the board. And I've been identifying that there's a prophetic warning message that comes, there is to be conversion that occurs at a certain point, and it concludes with the blotting out of our sin. And today I want to look at two last aspects of this process in connection with what we've been discussing. I want to have you turn with me, if you will, to John chapter 1. John chapter 1. This segment is entitled, By Beholding. By Beholding, and we're going to John chapter 1. And what I want to do in three scriptures is I want to show you that there is something that happens in the three different reform histories that Sister White is ever referencing. Can you, anyone remember what these three histories are that Sister White is always comparing? Do we know who they are? We are one. Who are the other two histories that she's always comparing among themselves?
Israelites.
The history of Christ,
the time of Christ.
And the history of the Millerites, and of course our history. These are the three that you see most commonly that she is drawing connections between them. So let's notice something that the Bible does, okay? John chapter 1, notice verse 29 with me. The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him, and saith, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. What was his commission? What was the command?
Behold
the Lamb of God. This segment here is entitled, By Beholding. Now, in Christ's day, what were they to behold, according to John?
The Lamb of God.
The Lamb of God. Why was it the Lamb of God? Why wasn't it the bridegroom?
Because he was sacrificial.
To be slaughtered as a lamb.
Because the focus John was bringing was that Christ was to come and fulfill that sacrificial lamb for us. And that was the focus of that history. Okay. But we know that that very cry is going to be heard here at the end of the world with us too. But let's go now, notice with me, Matthew 25. Matthew chapter 25 and verse 1. And of course, here's where we find our way into the beginning of the parable of the five wise and five foolish virgins. Let's read the first 6 verses together. We are in Matthew chapter 25 and beginning in verse 1. Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the who?
Bridegroom.
The bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. Now notice the next verse. Again the command. And at midnight there was a cry made, Behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go you out to meet him. Interesting that in each of these histories that Sister White has taken care through the spirit of prophecy has mentioned these three histories, and in each of these histories we're going to find the command to behold. In the history of Christ, it was to behold the Lamb of God. Now it's to behold the bridegroom. And why are they to behold the bridegroom?
Because the wedding is preeminent.
Okay, because there's a pending wedding. They understood that the coming of Christ was imminent, where the bridegroom would come and take his bride. Correct? And everybody would go back to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Well, that was that history. Now, we can also find many references in the spirit of prophecy, not only for the history of Christ, but for the history of the Millerites, that they are going to be repeated in our day. Okay, but let's go to Isaiah chapter 40. Isaiah chapter 40. And I'm establishing in our understanding that God specifically and intentionally sets a point in time where there is to be the command to behold. Okay? So Isaiah chapter 40, notice verse 9 with me. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 9 says, O Zion that bringest good tidings, get thee up into the high mountain, O Jerusalem, that bringest good tidings. Lift up thy voice with strength, lift it up, be not afraid. Say unto the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold your God. Now, all the prophets are writing more for our time than for their own. We know Isaiah is speaking about Zion, God's church here at the end of the world, is to give that cry, behold your God. But let me read to you here from Christ Object Lessons. I want to read to you a statement identifying this beholding, and specifically Isaiah 40. Sister White says, it is the darkness of misapprehension of God. That means misunderstanding. There's a darkness upon this earth because so many people don't understand God. He's been misrepresented to them, and this is represented as darkness. She says, it is the darkness of misapprehension or misunderstanding of God that is enshrouding the world. Men are losing their knowledge of what?
His character.
His character, okay? This is the problem that God has at the end of the world. Do you think that God, that the people today that profess to be God's people have a better understanding, since Sister White wrote this, of the character of God? No, we have women pastors. If we understood the character of God, we'd understand why we can't have women pastors. The same reason we can't have husbands as mothers to children. God has designated these roles for a specific purpose. Now, reading on, she says, men are losing their knowledge of his character. It has been misunderstood and misinterpreted. At this time, a message from God is to be proclaimed, a message illuminating in its influence and saving in its power. His character is to be made known. His character is to be made known. Into the darkness of the world is to be shed the light of his what?
Glory.
Of his glory. And his glory is his what?
Character.
His character. Shed the light of his glory or character, the light of his goodness, mercy, and truth. Now, it's interesting. So let's consider this. There's in our previous parts, what we looked at was this. We looked at the darkness of 2 Peter 1:19. And we have a more sure word of prophecy. That you would do well to take heed as unto a light that shineth in a dark place. This is a light that's shining in a dark place as well. Until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. So again, let's represent this darkness. And again, there is to be a light, as commanded here, that's to shine into this darkness. What is this light here? This darkness, we know, is misunderstanding.
So the light would be understanding.
The light would be present truth.
Is that right? Yes, a big word. So God wants, let's read this again, but let's take note of what this light is that's shining. We know the darkness is a misunderstanding. This is Isaiah 60. Arise and shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon thee. And there's darkness that covers the earth in gross darkness, the people. This darkness you identify as the same thing. It's a misunderstanding of God. It's an ignorance of who God really is. And specifically, she identifies it's his character. All right, which is referencing his glory. So the light that's to shine into this darkness, notice with me again, she says, into the darkness of the world is to be shed the light of his glory or
character.
Amen.
Okay? These are not my words, but this is what Sister White is telling us under inspiration. Okay? Let's notice that in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 19, that we would do well to take heed of what? In 2 Peter 1:19, what is it that we're to do well? We would do well if we took heed of. What is it that's shining into the darkness there?
Well,
does anybody remember?
The sure word of prophecy.
The sure word of prophecy. But wait a minute, this isn't the light of prophecy. Now we're seeing that it's the light of God's character. So what I want you to see and recognize is there's two prongs to this light that are to shine into the darkness. Okay? We can never dispense with the prophetic warning message. It's the light that shines into the darkness until the day star dawn, the day dawn and the day star arise in your heart, until the glory of God begins to shine in your own heart. And we're going to open this up more, but I want you to see that there are two components that are represented as light in connection with 2 Peter that are represented as a light that's shining into the darkness. This is misunderstanding, but we also identified that it represented in previously in these parts that we're in this that are part of this series is disobedience. So, just putting this as a visual for us to understand better that the light that is to shine into this darkness is the, and Sister White's words, is to be shed the light of the glory, I'm sorry, the light of his glory, the light of his goodness, mercy, and truth. Okay, which embraces the prophetic warning message, but truth is something that is not always understood. There's a statement where Sister White will identify, and I don't know that I have it in this set of notes that you have here today. We've read it before. It's in our The Experience series. We've read this quote, where the knowledge that we are to have, in fact, I'll have it ready for part six when we start up. I'll bring that quote forward in reference to this, and I'll read it to you. But what she's telling us is there is one knowledge that we all must have in order to be saved, and that's the knowledge of God's character as reflected in the life of Jesus Christ, or as she says, the truth as it is in Jesus. Okay, the example of Christ was to show us who the Father truly is. And that's the whole reason that the Son came, aside from saving us, is he was to show the world who God the Father truly is. And here we're reading about the greatest problem here at the end of the world. The problem that's creating the darkness is people do not understand who God really is. And we're going to discover as we go forward that when we understand who God truly is, when we begin to understand our Father, there is a love that is awakened. There's a loyalty that is set in us as a result of this. As we behold, we become changed. This section, again, is entitled By Beholding. I want to read to you the second paragraph of this statement in Christ's Object Lesson. She goes on and says, "This is the work outlined by the prophet Isaiah in the words, quote, O Jerusalem that bringest good tidings, lift up thy voice with strength. Lift it up, be not afraid. Say unto the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord God will come with strong hand, and his arm shall rule for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his work before him." Recapping now, we read in John chapter 1, John is telling the people, behold the Lamb of God in that history. Then we read in Matthew 25 in the parable, behold the bridegroom. It was pertinent that they understood their relationship to the bridegroom. And then Isaiah is saying, for our day, and Sister White just confirmed, that we are to say, behold your God. There is a quote here from Christ's Object Lessons, page 415, the next paragraph that I want to read to you. And it says this, those who wait for the bridegroom's coming. Are we waiting for the bridegroom's coming? Yes, we are. When will he arrive? When does the bridegroom arrive in our history?
At the when Michael stands up.
At the Sunday law. Behold, the bridegroom cometh, go you out to meet him. The cry, the midnight cry, is prefiguring our loud cry. As an example, midnight cry in the history of the Millerites empowered the second angel's message. When it did, the Spirit of God was poured out without measure. And there was a short period of time between there and when the door shut on Adventism and Christ stood up to move from the holy to the most holy. In our parallel history, we're going to see the third angel's message empowered at the loud cry. The God's Spirit is poured out without measure, and there's a short distance before again the door is shut, and Michael stands up again and says it is finished. The midnight cry of that history is paralleled to our loud cry. And so when we are to hear the cry, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go you out to meet him, that cry is heard from the Sunday law forward. And it is paralleling the loud cry, or prefiguring, I should say, the loud cry. She says, those who wait for the bridegroom's coming are to say to the people, behold your God, the last rays of merciful light, the last message of mercy to be given to the world, is a revelation of his character of love. How is it that there's going to be a revelation of his character of love? This obviously is indicating somebody's going to be reflecting his character. So the point is that God is giving a command to behold, and the purpose we want to now discover, why it is that we're to behold, and what are we to behold, but we're to behold our God, and that is the command that we are to give as well. Notice this grace, okay, because see the close of that last paragraph, Christ's Object Lessons, page 415, the end of paragraph 5, in their own life and character, they are to reveal what the grace of God has done for them. Now notice your next quote, identifying what this grace is at one level. She says in the devotional, Lift Him Up, there must be a deep work of grace, the love of God in the heart. And this love is expressed by obedience. So, the grace of God is what we are to reveal to the world. We want to show them, reading again above there, in their own life and character, they are to reveal what the grace of God has done for them. So what has the love of God in your heart done for you? What has the grace of God done in our lives? Well, God is going to have a people who are going to reflect this, reveal this to the whole world, and they are going to behold that, and by beholding they become changed. This is the lifting up of Christ at that time. Now, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, if you will, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, chapter 3 of 2 Corinthians, and notice verse 18. Let's look at this principle that warrants this particular title. But we all with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord. And what do we just discover the glory of the Lord is? It's his character. Are changed into the same image, or changed into the same character, from glory to glory, or from revelation of his character to revelation of his character to the revelation of his character. The more we behold Christ in the life, the Father, I should say, in the life of Christ, the more we discover who God is. But this study will bring this focus to a fine point. The spirit of prophecy will indicate for us where we truly need to be looking. But notice, from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. So the transformation of character is being accomplished by God's Spirit. We know this because the Bible says, not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord of hosts, silently and perceptibly. Okay, and as you remember the quote of Sister White where she says of the stones that they quarried from all over the world, but the stone for the temples were quarried from the mountain, and they were chiseled and hammered and square, and they were brought and placed and fitted for their place in the temple, and then the work, though, was done elsewhere. And it's representing the work of the Holy Spirit, which is done silent and imperceptibly. But we want to notice that it is by beholding the character of God. Now, the character of God can be revealed. How? How do we behold the character of God? If my brother here is reflecting his character, if he is self-sacrificing, if he is, or my sister over here is very giving of her time, patient, and long-suffering.
He will have the fruits of the Spirit.
Amen, the fruits of the Spirit. Praise the Lord. So it's by beholding these fruits and seeing these in the lives of others that helps us to get a glimpse of who Jesus really is. Now, I want to read to you from Testimonies on Sexual Behavior, page 108, paragraph 2. One steadfast look to the Savior, uplifted upon the cross, will do more to purify the mind and heart from every defilement than will all the scientific explanations by the ablest tongue. Isn't that amazing? Now, think about this. What we're going to discover in this study is that as we behold Christ upon the cross, there is a power that joins with that. Unexplainable power. Comprehensible power. Comprehensible power. And what I want us to see today is that so far what we're looking at is that Christ in each Reformed history is commanding us to behold something. And what he's always asking us to behold is the Lamb of God, is the Bridegroom, is our God. Behold your God. All of them are always Christ. And by beholding Christ, we're going to discover something happens for us. Something in our Christian walk comes into place that wasn't there before. Okay? We become changed. Amen. So let me read to you again now. This is taken from Messages to Young People, page 137, beginning in paragraph 3. Jesus Christ, now listen, before I read this, I want you to consider, some are teaching, have taught, probably will teach, that I can become transformed in character, prepared to meet with Jesus in peace from the Sunday law forward by studying God's Word. And that is all I need to do. Now we need to realize that God has marked out what it is that does transform our character. And it's not just by reading and studying something. Praise the Lord for His Word. That Word, as we said last time we were together, that Word is the means, but it is not the end. It is the tool that God uses to awaken us to His will. And we need the Word of God. But let's notice this quote. Jesus Christ laid on hold on humanity, and with His human arm, He might encircle the race, while with His divine arm, He grasped the throne of the infinite. He planted His cross midway between earth and heaven and said, I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto Me. The cross was to be the center of attraction. It was to speak to all men and draw them across the gulf that sin had made to unite finite man with the infinite God. It is the power of the cross alone that can separate man from the strong confederacy of sin. That's powerful. It's the cross alone. Well, brother, what does that mean? Well, let's look at one thing. What is the cross teaching us? Many things, but what are some of the things that the cross is teaching us in connection with what we're studying right now?
Humble.
Overcoming sin. Transformation of character. Sorry?
Humble obedience.
Humble obedience. Silent as the lamb was before its shearers. Okay. In Matthew 5, Jesus says, I did not come to do away with the law, but what?
To fulfill it.
And also elsewhere, to make it honorable. Well, what does that mean? What does that mean to me as a Christian sitting in the church today? Why is the cross so significant? One of the things that you'll discover as you study the situation of the cross, the circumstances, many today will preach the Word of God separate from Christ. They'll preach the power of the Word, but they won't bring Christ into it. In this study, as we conclude this study today with these last two parts, we are going to show that there needs to be a balance and that right now there's an imbalance in our message in most circles. Let's look at this now. Christ came to fulfill the law. What did He come to fulfill? Thou shalt not commit adultery. What does that mean? That He came to fulfill the law. What did the law demand of a sinner?
Death.
It demanded the shedding of blood. This is how the law speaks to us. It demands that there must be the shedding of blood or there's no remission of sins. Hebrews will teach us this. Okay, so Jesus came to fulfill the law at that level. He's showing us that the law is immutable. It cannot be changed. The God of heaven, think about it now, when at a practical personal level, we all have our little pet sins. But like faith as a mustard seed, it is still faith because by definition, it is faith. Size is irrelevant. And God will tell you that that little bit of faith, if you have it as big as a mustard seed, I can do something with that. Because all inclusively, it is faith. And I can work with that. And in the same time, sin, no matter how small we want to make it in our lives, to God it is still sin by definition, and it has to go. So when Jesus came to die upon that cross, he is teaching us that the law cannot bend the slightest degree for that little pet sin in my life, that it has to go. And that Jesus had to go the whole distance on that cross and lay down his life to pay the debt of my sins and of your sins. So, in this respect, he came to fulfill the law, but he also came to fulfill the law and that he lived a life free from violation of the law to show us that we can do that, not in our power and strength, not in our humanity, but by the Spirit of God who worketh in us to will and to do of his good pleasure. Now, I'm touching on some things that I'm not trying to make a prominent theme of thought, but where I'm trying to go with this is that by beholding, we're to become changed. And in this quote we just read, the power of the cross alone that separates man from the strong confederacy of sin. The cross has something there that inspiration wants us to understand that is so powerful that if we look, we will live. Remember the serpents in the wilderness, Deuteronomy 29, I believe it was, or 22. As they were being stung by the serpents, what did the serpents represent? What did the fiery serpents represent?
Sin.
The fiery bite of the serpent was to represent the effects of sin. And yet, the sin was killing people. And if you read the account, especially in the spirit of prophecy, it's an amazing thing to discover that some would not look to that serpent upon the staff. And they died in their sin. And all they had to do was look and they would be healed. That's amazing. Today, Jesus is teaching us still that though the serpent of sin bites us now and the effects are fiery, that we can look and live. We can overcome through the power of the cross. Now, you say, well, brother, that's great. You're now preaching an unbalanced message. I'm going to bring balance to this message. But I'm highlighting one aspect, one prong, if you will, of this two-prong ray of light. Yes, prophetic warning message, justice. God says his throne, the attributes of his throne are both justice and mercy. And we preach justice, but we've left off the mercy for too long. So what I'm identifying right now is this part, but I'm going to bring the two of them together shortly, or before we leave here. Now, what's the result of beholding? Okay, let's notice this statement from the book Education, page 192, beginning in paragraph 1. The great motive powers of the soul are faith, hope, and love. It is to these that Bible study, rightly pursued, appeals. The outward beauty of the Bible, the beauty of imagery and expression, is but the setting, as it were. Excuse me. For its real treasure, the Bible's real treasure, the beauty of holiness. The beauty of the Bible is what? Holiness. That's what the Bible is wanting to portray. And where does the holiness derive from? From our Father. Jesus is the Word. He's the only begotten Son of the Father. The Word of God comes forth from the Father to help us to understand who the Father is. Why? So that we're just educated? No, because God wants us to fall in love with Him. And so the written word wasn't having the effect that He wanted. And so He sends His only begotten Son to live every principle of the word. I believe with all my heart when I get to heaven, I'm going to discover that Jesus in His lifetime lived every single principle that's in this Bible. Every single one of them. That He fulfilled every one of those principles and He did it successfully. Okay? Now, notice what she says. In its record, the Bible that is, in its record of the men who walked with God, we may catch glimpses of His glory. Where are you going to find these glimpses of glory? Based on what we just read? Just in the Bible at large? Where does it say? It says, in its record of the men who walked with God, comma, we may catch glimpses of His glory. So the glory of God is revealed in the lives that were recorded there for us, Daniel, Enoch, and others, Isaiah, and so forth. Here is where we catch a glimpse of the character or glory of God. This is where we see people who are reflecting His character. And as we read these things, by beholding, we're becoming changed. She goes on and says, in the one altogether lovely, we behold Him, of whom all beauty of earth and heaven is but a dim reflection. I, if I be lifted up, He said, will draw all men unto me. As the student of the Bible beholds the Redeemer, there is awakened in the soul. Now, I don't understand how this works, but we're being told how this works now and why we are to behold. There is awakened in the soul the mysterious power of faith, adoration, and what? And love. Upon the vision of Christ, the gaze is fixed. And the beholder grows into the likeness of that which he adores. The words of the Apostle Paul become the language of the soul. Quote, I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings. Do you want to know Jesus Christ? Is this our fervent prayer? Because to know Him is life eternal, John 17:3. This is what Paul was writing up. Now, what I want to do with you now, I want you to come with me to a setting that you're familiar with, but I want you to see something in this that you may not have seen before. Okay, we're going to look at Peter and his example of someone who looked and by beholding became changed. You follow me? Okay, this is taken from Christ Object Lessons. And I want to read to you beginning at page 152. For each of the classes represented by the Pharisee and the publican, there is a lesson in the history of the Apostle Peter. In his early discipleship, Peter thought himself strong. Like the Pharisee, in his own estimation, he was, quote, not as other men are, unquote. When Christ, on the eve of his betrayal, forewarned his disciples, all ye shall be offended because of me this night, Peter confidently declared, although all shall be offended, yet will not I. There is a pride and self-sufficiency here that God was aware of that Peter was not aware of. And friends, I'm just suggesting to you and I that there are things in our character that we're not aware of, but God sees as clear as the noonday sun. Peter did not know his own danger. There you go. Self-confidence misled him. He thought himself able to withstand temptation, but in a few short hours, the test came, and with cursing and swearing, he denied his Lord. Have mercy. He's like those that say, I will never go to church on Sunday. I know that Saturday is the Sabbath. But if we receive not a love for the truth in 2 Thessalonians, we will receive a strong delusion and we will believe a lie. When the crowing of the cock reminded him of the words of Christ, surprised and shocked at what he had just done, watch this. He turned and looked at his master. Where was he? When the cock crowed, where was Christ? He was in that courtyard, interrogated, beaten. You know, I'm not exactly sure at what point there. I don't believe the physical abuse had started in earnest yet. And listen to this. At that moment, Christ looked at Peter. He just denied his God. He didn't just deny him. He did it with cursing and swearing. This is the man who was in the presence of Christ for how long? 3.5 years. Think about Isaiah in chapter 6. He's the prophet of God, and he comes to a dawning of understanding. I am a man of unclean lips. And he's been prophesying. He looked at Peter, and beneath that grieved look, beneath it, in which compassion and love for him were blended, Peter understood himself. And what I'm telling you, friends, is that as we look to Jesus upon that cross, can you see him hanging there? Can you see the sweat, the thorns, the grime and the dirt, the naked form, not with the quilt, the cloth that we put around him for the sake of the children, but totally in a humiliating position and condition, having to force himself up by his feet, which are pinned to the tree, in order to gasp a breath of air. And when we look at him, are we understanding ourselves? Do we understand what our sin is doing? And even now, as I say that, there are those that will hear this and push away from the work that the Holy Spirit's doing right now to show us that even that little pet sin in our life, that little sin will keep us from heaven if we don't confess and forsake it. Whatever it may be. Friends, we want total freedom. Peter wanted total freedom. He went out and wept bitterly. That look of Christ broke his heart. Peter had come to the turning point, and bitterly did he repent his sin. He was like the publican in his contrition and repentance. And like the publican, he found mercy. Amen? He found mercy. The look of Christ, the look of Christ. This, don't miss this. I'm going to bring this up later. But the look of Christ assured him of pardon. Amen. The look of Christ assured him of pardon. As a sinner, you and I, when we behold Christ, do you want to see pardon in the eyes of Christ? I do. Now his self-confidence was gone. Never again were the old boastful assertions repeated. Notice with me John chapter 21. If you'll come with me to John chapter 21. And I want to take up this story in the Bible. And notice with me verse 14. We just want to read 4 verses here. And again, these are familiar, but don't let your familiarity separate you from receiving the blessing that God would bring in these verses today. Verse 14 of chapter 21 in John says, this is now the third time. Actually, let's go back to verse 12. Jesus saith unto them, come and dine. And none of the disciples durst ask him, who art thou? Knowing that it was the Lord. Jesus then cometh and taketh bread and giveth them, and fish likewise. This is now the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples after that he was risen from the dead. So when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, okay, so they're all sitting there, the fire's crackling, the evening glow is setting in the sky, they're there, they're full, they're relaxed, and now Jesus has their undivided attention. Every temporal need has been fulfilled right there. And so now he comes and he takes Peter and puts him on center stage. And we know in inspiration, the reason is because he denied his Lord 3 times, 3 times he had to ask him, but I want you to see the result of this interrogation. And I might say it was done in love, of course. So when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? Who are these? Who are these that he's speaking about?
The other disciples.
The other disciples. Do you love me more than these? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, what? What does he tell him to do?
Feed my lambs.
What I want you to see, and you're going to see this several times, Jesus wants to know if one thing is in place first before he can ask you to do a certain thing. What's the one thing that he wants to know is in place first?
Do you love me?
Do you love me? If you love me, then you're prepared to feed my sheep. But if you don't love me, I don't want you anywhere near my sheep. This is what I want you to see. So we read on. Verse 16. He saith to him again, the second time, Son, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. Would you see the pattern upon the testimony of two or three? If you don't have a love for Jesus first, and I'm not talking about the lips of profession, that Jesus says they draw near me with lying lips, but their heart is far from me. He wants to know of you today, do you love me, Wesley? If you love me, then you're prepared to go feed my sheep. Verse 17, he saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. And can't today, if we're honest, can't we say, Lord, you know what's in my heart. You know that I love you. You know that I do. So if that's the case with each of us today, Jesus' commission is, feed my sheep. You see, Peter had to behold Christ in order to have a conversion, in order to enable him to truly love Jesus and appreciate who he is before he was able to even go and do work for Christ. And this is what I see the Lord is calling to us today to see. Continuing on, though, with Christ Object Lessons, beginning in paragraph 154, paragraph 2. Christ, after his resurrection, thrice tested Peter. Simon, son of Jonas, he said, lovest thou me more than these? Peter did not now exalt himself above his brethren. He appealed to the one who could read his heart. Lord, he said, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. You know it. See, it wasn't any more striving, or our ministry over this ministry, or this brother over this brother, or I'm of Apollos, and I'm of Paul, I'm Paul, and all this garbage, friends. The single focus was Christ. You see here on the board, I was drawing this earlier for a brother here, that this represents what Sister White saw in vision. And it represents, each of these lines represents the walk of different individuals upon this earth. Christ is the center. He's the hub. We're all making our way to Christ. And notice, as my walk gets closer to Christ, it also gets closer to my brother and my sister on either side of me. Amen. And so, friends, if we stay focused on Jesus, if we keep our eyes focused on him and behold the Lamb of God, behold the bridegroom, behold our God, that's what we need to focus on. Because automatically, we're going to have a love for other souls, and our focus will be correct. We're going to be drawn closer together because we have the same passion, the same desire, and the same journey. Reading on, she says, then he received his commission. See, do you love me? You know that I love you. She says, then he received his commission. A work broader and more delicate. A what?
Work.
A work broader and more delicate than had heretofore been his was appointed him. Now he was prepared to do the work. What was he going to do next? Jesus had already been crucified. He had risen. He came and fed them. This was the third time. He was about to leave. So what was he preparing him for? The work that we read about in Acts. Okay, this is the carrying of the message across the globe. And brothers and sisters, in order for you and I to give the loud cry that's going to carry this message around the world, in order for you and I to be fitted for that, we have to behold the Lamb of God. We have to behold the bridegroom who's coming. And we have to behold our God and realize that He is God and there is no other. That all power in both heaven and earth is His to dispense to those who believe. Reading on, she says, Christ bade him feed the sheep and the lambs. In thus committing to his stewardship the souls for whom the Savior had laid down his own life, Christ gave to Peter the strongest proof of confidence in his restoration. The restless, boastful, self-confident disciple had become subdued and contrite. Henceforth, he followed his Lord in self-denial and self-sacrifice. He was a partaker of Christ's sufferings, and when Christ shall sit upon the throne of his glory, Peter will be a partaker in his glory. And that can be our story, friends. And so Jesus asks us today, Wesley, do you love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. Then feed my sheep. Now, the reason I bring that up, as we move into the second portion of this, which is love and works. So Peter is showing us in this story example, what Christ shows us is there's a reason that he asks him three times. We understand that's restoring him for the three times that he denied. That's reconciliation. But notice that the end result is had to establish the love first, the first love, the love first, the first love, and then you go to work for Jesus.
Amen.
Okay? Now, so let's see if that holds up. I want to read this to you from, now this is a quote taken from Testimonies Volume 8, beginning in paragraph 1 of page 98. We've broken it up with two scriptures. She quotes the scriptures in the verse within the context, but we're going to read them together, so I put them this way on the paper. She says, the messages to the church of Ephesus and the church in Sardis have been often repeated to me by the one who gives me instruction for his people. Who are the people that she's given instruction for?
Adventist people.
No, I'm talking of the seven churches. You're right.
Oh.
Of the seven churches, who is she? Because we're talking about Ephesus and Sardis. And she says that these have been often repeated to me by the one who gives me instruction for his people. Who are her people in that history?
The Laodicean people.
Okay. Now the reason I'm making that observation is because she's going to show us that the council to Ephesus and Sardis are constantly for her, more often than any other, are constantly being applied to Laodicea here today at the end of the world. So let's notice what they are. Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2. We'll begin in verse 1 and we'll notice the council given to Ephesus. Which church was Ephesus? What number church was Ephesus? They were the first church. Okay, this was the apostolic church. This is the church that Peter was counseled and commissioned to go and feed the sheep. Okay, this was the raising up of the church as we understood it. So read in verse 1 with me. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write. Now take this counsel to Laodicea. That's you and I. These things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works, and thy labor, and thy patience, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles, and are not, and hast found them liars. That's proof texting, by the way. That's comparing line upon line. Scripture with scripture, here a little, there a little. And hast borne and hast patience, and for my name's sake hast labored and hast not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast fallen from thy first love.
Left.
We left it. That's a decision. It's not, oops, you wake up one day and you're no longer in love with Christ, the truth. You've left it. That means you made a decision. You were confronted with your will or God's will, and you chose your will. Notice verse 5, remember therefore from whence thou art fallen. Remember. Why? Because you're not aware that you've even fallen. We'll discover. And repent. Notice now, repent. Come back over to this side. The thing that I've been identifying is in the first step is repentance. When the prophetic warning message comes, repentance is the objective of Christ, is to bring repentance. Amen. By beholding Christ upon the cross, this is these three steps. When the prophetic warning message comes, the message causes us to behold the Lamb of God. Because when you're told that probation is about to close for you at the son-in-law, and you realize how near that is, and you take inventory of yourself, and you realize that you're not ready to meet Jesus at all. You know that there's sin in your life that you've allowed and that you permit on a regular basis. You know how you treat His holy Sabbath day, which we will
continue to enjoy from one new moon to the next. Brothers and sisters, that's the prophetic warning message. And what it does is it brings repentance. Okay, we read the accounts and the stories before, but repentance is one of the things that is a result of that prophetic warning message coming into our hearts and minds. So when that warning comes, it causes, well, let me read on. Revelation chapter 3, just come over to chapter 3, notice verse 1 with me. We'll read verses 1 through 3. So I'm pointing out that in verse 5 of chapter 2, remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent. And then the next thing it says, and do the first works. Wait a minute. The first works, what are the first works? We'll come to that in a moment. But notice, we're to return to our first love, and then we're to do the first works. Okay, so we want to identify what these are. Revelation 3 verse 1 says, and unto the angel of the church in Sardis write these things, saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and are dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and what?
Repent.
If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come unto thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Reading the last piece of this statement in Testimonies, Volume 8, page 98, we are seeing the fulfillment of these warnings. Never have scriptures been more strictly fulfilled than these have been. That is quite a statement. I don't know of any statement that she makes like that concerning anything else. Ezekiel 9 will be literally fulfilled, but here she's saying that never have scriptures been more strictly fulfilled than these have been. Have been. In other words, Christ is coming and he's taking the candlestick away of those who do not repent, return to their first love, and do the first works. All right? But I want to show you something really, really awesome. Okay? Now, notice this next quote with me, taken from Acts of the Apostles, page 388, beginning in paragraph 2. Paul pleaded with those who had once known in their lives, the power of God, to return to their first love of the gospel truth. I read that again. Paul pleaded with those who had once known in their lives the power of God, comma, to return to their first love of gospel truth. What is the power of God? Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. What is the gospel of Jesus Christ? What is it? They preached it. What was it? The cross. The gospel is Christ dying for our sins as an atonement for our sins, making a way across a gulf that there was no previous way, making a way for us to enter into heaven or enter into the most holy place by faith, to come boldly before that throne of grace, that we might receive grace in time of need. What I want to identify in this quote is this. They had once known in their lives the power of God. They were counseled to return to their first love of gospel truth. What is the gospel? It's the Word of God. And the Word of God is seed. The truth is, the gospel truth is seed, correct? We read about the parable of it falling upon the stony hearts, upon the sun coming up and not taking root and all of this. But the Word of God is seed. What does that seed produce? Let me ask you like that. I don't know if you ever thought about this. This is really awesome. So you've got the Word of God. The seed, the soul is your heart. So here comes the seed. We know it's the Word of God. It falls on the heart. And let's say the heart is saying, praise the Lord, yeah, bring it on. And it starts to grow. It starts to germinate. And what comes up through the soil of the heart? What is it? Our brother says love, joy, and peace. But what is it? This is really, really awesome. Now watch. I'm going to read you this quote from Fundamentals of Christian Education, page 280. Love is a very precious plant. and must be cultivated if it flourishes. There's more I want to read you, but I want to tell you what I'm seeing. When the seed of God is planted in our heart, the Spirit comes along and waters it. And if we are to return where? To our first love. What is that? That's the place where you encountered the truth in your heart, and that little plant of love pops up through the surface. That's the first love. When does that happen in the whole scheme of planting and harvesting? What time of rain is that? Sorry?
The latter rain?
The latter rain causes it to come up out of the ground? That's the former rain. And in one place in the Bible and the spirit of prophecy, it's called the first rain. Now think about this.
There's work to do because it says to be cultivated.
Amen. Amen. All right, we're going to go there. But I want to draw this in your mind. I want you to see this. What I'm saying is, 9-11 to the Sunday law, let's do this first. Go to Joel chapter 2. Joel chapter 2. And I want to put this in place first. It'll make much more sense. And you'll understand why I'm using the reasoning that I'm using. But in Joel chapter 2 and verse 23. Actually, let's go to verse 22 above it. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field.
Joel what?
2:22. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring. For the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God. For he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. So there's going to come down for us the former rain and the latter rain. We're told to rejoice. Now, when this comes down, it comes down prior to the harvest that's about to come at summer. You have to have the latter rain before you have the harvest. So to send the former rain and then the latter rain, they both are going to precede the harvest. And what do you know? Verse 24 says, and the floors shall be full of wheat, and the fat shall overflow with wine and oil. And then verse 25, and I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, the cankerworm and the caterpillar and the palm worm, my great army which I sent among you. The former rain and the latter rain. Notice now.
Would the former rain be equated with the first love?
Would the former rain be equated with the first love? Absolutely. That's what I'm about to draw. So you think about it. And I have other quotes that we'll read to build on this, but I want to put this in your mind, in the framework of your mind, and as we read, you consider this context. Former rain, latter rain, before the harvest. We know the latter rain has come. And I'm not saying that former rain wasn't Pentecost. Sister White, you'll discover, she's not saying that either. But she will take that quote, that verse 23, combine it with Zechariah 10:1, we're to pray for rain in the time of the latter rain. And then she couples with that when that rain comes, we're going to receive both the former and the latter rain. Okay? First love. Right here. Seed. First love. It's becoming acquainted with the truth and falling in love with the character of God all over again. And why? Well, why do I need that? I'm a good Seventh-day Adventist. I'm an elder in the church. I've been in the church fourth generation. What do you mean? I don't need a first love. Yes, you do. You've left your first love. And we'll discover the leaving of the first love is the allowing of sin to come into our life, a separation from God. And you said it. It has to be cultivated. Love, the plant of love, this tender plant of heavenly origin, it has to be cultivated and maintained. But we as Laodiceans, we've gotten away from our first love. And what's being identified is, what I'm suggesting to you is that the first love is when the former rain, the first rain, is given in this final history collectively to bring Laodiceans back into that first love experience. That's what the former rain is for. And then the latter rain as well, to ripen the grain and prepare for the harvest, to develop the fruit on that plant of love. What does it mean that we are to grow up into the full stature of men and women in Christ Jesus? That means that the plant of love will so fully grow within us. What is love? It's the character of God. To develop the character of Christ in us is to allow that plant to grow into its full maturity and produce the fruits: long-suffering, patience, goodness, meekness, gentleness. First love is the former rain. First love is the first rain. It is given to bring us back into connection, that first love. It's the same love. Right here, Jesus is saying, Wesley, do you love me? Well, if you do, yes, Lord, you know what? If you do, then feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. But I want to build on this. Now, I've set that before you. And things are making noises that shouldn't be making noises. But, okay, so I want to build on that. Reading this, beginning of that quote again from Fundamentals of Christian Education, page 280, paragraph 1. Love is a very precious plant and must be cultivated if it flourishes. The precious plant of love is to be treated tenderly, and they put practiced, okay? And it will become strong and vigorous and rich in what? Woo-hoo! Fruit bearing. Do you want that plant?
Amen.
I want that plant, brothers and sisters. Jesus today is saying to you, is saying to all of us, that we are to return to the first love. That's where Peter went, friends. Did he not know Jesus before? Did he not sit at his feet? Did he not know the words of Christ? But he wasn't getting it. He was representing Laodicea. He was proud and puffed up, rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, knowing not that he was wretched, poor, miserable, blind, and naked. But then he beheld Jesus. That look of Christ, and it transformed who he was. And as a result, he was broken. He was never the same man again. Self-sufficiency. Self was destroyed. So that when Jesus then could come to him and say, do you love me, Peter, more than these? The ones that you were vying for position? Do you love me? Oh, Lord, you know I love you more. And this is what Jesus is trying to accomplish in us. Think about it. You know what this is? When he asked him, Peter, do you love me more than these? He was redeeming him from among men in order that he could follow the Lamb whithersoever he goeth.
Amen.
That's the only way it can happen, is if we are redeemed from among men. Amen?
Amen.
So reading on, it says, giving expression to the whole character. Let me include that whole thing. I apologize. There's just so much here. The precious plant of love is to be treated tenderly or practiced, and it will become strong and vigorous and rich in fruit bearing, giving expression to the whole character. It were better not to live than to exist day by day devoid of that love which Christ has revealed in his character and has enjoined upon his children. Said Christ, love one another as I have loved you. Brothers and sisters, we're going to build upon this in our next part. We're going to pause here now. But I want you to realize, let me just recap part 5 for us here. Jesus gives the command in 3 different histories to behold the Lamb, behold the bridegroom, and behold your God. There's a reason God is commanding us to behold. The commission, the command is not one of indifference. God does it with love. He wants you and I to understand that by beholding, the principle of becoming changed into the same image is going to be so beneficial for us. And how it benefits us is that by beholding, we can return to that first love. We fall in love with Christ all over again. By beholding, we become changed into the same image, and the image of God is love. In doing that, in returning to the first love, we're also understanding that the first rain or the former rain experience is occurring in this very history. When God is giving us a prophetic warning message, we're going to look at this process more closely, but I'm telling you in advance that as we behold Christ upon that cross, as Peter did in the courtyard, we see ourselves a sinner and we are broken if we are honest Christians. Sister White says every truly honest soul will come to the light of truth. If we're honest souls, and what happens is love is awakened in us. There's a power that stirs within us and we want what Jesus has to offer us, that being eternal life. and we are converted, we come to that place of repentance and experience true conversion. But that plant of love comes at the time of the first to form a rain. And that's what we want to build upon as we come together in part six. So as we close, if you will, you'll join me as we seek our Father in prayer. Our Holy Father, oh, how precious you are. How wonderful, how gracious. And just think, we'll get to sit at your feet for eternity. Praise the King. Loving Father, I pray for forgiveness of my sins, whatever has separated me from you. And I pray, Father, that you would vanquish self within us, because that is what keeps us from the glory of God. It's our own self-will. Dear Jesus, may we behold you, and by beholding, be transformed into the same beautiful, glorious image. And dear Father, we pray for power to overcome. We pray for a greater faith than we now possess, because the just shall live by that faith. Dear God, we want a faith also that works by love and purifies our soul. We thank you for your blessed Sabbath. We thank you for the truth for this time. Please guide and keep us and bring us together again in your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.